over to the House of Lords today. This is a wonderful day that we have the privilege to share in the buildings of God and all that He has done for us. And so we're glad to be a part. I want to just quickly highlight some of these baptism candidates that received them in the service, and I want you to celebrate them with me if they're at the 9/11. And we have these wonderful keepsakes for them for their baptism. Rebecca Camille. Jace Camille, which is part of the Bible service. Jay Camille again. This is the young one. Jacques Camille. Lord, there's all the Camilles got baptized. We baptized the whole family in Jesus' name. Daniela Mizzou. Daniela Desmond. Diana Powell. Diana Powell. Natasha Mercius, Amanda March is 11:30. So 9:30, don't need to get baptized, what they say. Imani Hartfield, she's one of our youth that was baptized. She's in our youth department. Ricarius Duffy. Kayla Diaz. You know what? If I pay attention, I think they said they're doing this at 11. That's why they ain't on here. Praise the Lord. I'm not giving out the first time. All right. Don't forget, this Friday is prayer. We have prayer this Friday. And this is the schedule that you need. The last one for someone who has an inaccurate phone number. But the prayer line number is 712-432-6100. It's 712-432-6100. We'll be praying tomorrow at 5:30 a.m. The code that you need to get in is 882-54263. 882-54263. 882-54263. So we'll be praying online tomorrow at 5:30, Monday and Wednesday at 5:30. We're asking, if you did not get these handouts, our ushers will gather them and start passing them out by chance. We're asking this Wednesday, we're fasting. That's a curse word, I know. Leave it to only until 6. Check with your doctor to make sure you're well and able to do so. Wednesday, fasting until 6, and we'll join here in the sanctuary at 7. Don't forget, this Friday, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor. This Friday is prayer, 10 p.m. So after you come from the step show, come to prayer on Friday night. About classic settings. So please, Friday night, we have John Felton come to worship with us, and his worship team is going to be exciting. Worship and prayer is going to be great. We have scripture readings for you to read Monday morning and Wednesday. John 3, Romans 7, Wednesday evening, Psalm 27, Colossians 1. So we'll be praying 5:30 in the morning Monday, and then 5:30 on Wednesday, as well as fasting on Wednesday, and then prayers Friday night at 10 p.m. I'm praying my friend Jari to come worship with us. It's going to be incredible. Bring somebody with you for prayer. Invite somebody with you. It's going to be a great experience, and I don't want you to miss it. In these times, we all could draw closer to God. Somebody say that. And so I want you to make that valiant effort in doing so. All right. Turn with me to Psalm 121. In preparation for this Sunday morning, I was preparing on renewal for revival, and then kind of got turned around because of the current context of the world that we're living in. And any good leader will listen to the cries on the outside to determine what should he minister on. it's important to not just ignore the elephants in our room, but to ensure that we speak to the overarching thoughts that are on the minds of God's children. And so, in already having a prayer, I decided to call it audible. And there's one expression I would like to express on this particular morning. Upon this week and watching so many people respond, some with contentment, some with distraught, some with disappointment. The overarching theme that was highlighted was twofold. One was that we have, as a country, a lot of work to do as it relates to racial reconciliation. And number two, it also highlighted where the hearts of Christian people really are as it relates to their understanding of God and the kingdom in their life. We read so many people moving from the United States and they're still here. We heard people going back to Africa who have never bought a ticket to Africa and are still here. And so after you get through all of the foolery that is sometimes projected upon us, there has to be something to the place where you come to and say, where do we go from here? And my assignment is, number one, as a spiritual leader, is not to invoke fear in the heart, but to incite faith in the heart. Number one, scripture tells us, Romans 13, is that we are to pray for all of our neighbors, whether you like it or not, and your responsibility is to pray for others. We do find the hypocrisy of our nation that everybody wants us to respect the office and give credence to the office, but they didn't do that for 8 years. But we will, as Christians, do our part in praying for our president, elect, those in our present currently serving. But I really want to highlight from a Christian perspective, like, where do you go from here? Like, what's the next step that we go? And just so you're clear, I was an independent, so I don't have affiliation with that, and I go for honesty. But I voted because that's the right thing to do. But at the end of the day, I also know that we have a responsibility as Christians to have a different worldview than everybody else. So I'm not jumping off the ship. I'm not moving anywhere. I believe even if you're in a time of famine, God can prosper you right where you are. So let me give you some biblical backdrop on what to do when you don't have an idea on what to do. Psalm 121 reads as such, and if you're there, say I'm there. If you're not there, I'm sure you're not, because I just told you to turn there. Psalm 121, and some of you probably located quite quickly on your tablet or your iPhone, because most of us don't have Bibles. Psalm 121 says, I lift up my eyes to the mountains, from where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let his foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade. Not the shade y'all thinking of. The Lord is your shade. At your right hand, the sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. I want to talk from a particular subject called look up, look out, and look within. The writer, some suppose, as Daniel, is oppressed with the burdens and sorrows of exile. He is penning and remembering the days of Zion. He sings his soul to quietness and peace by looking away from the present concerns that he sees facing him. And as he's looking at the present uncertainty facing him, he begins to look up to the hills of God and cheers his drooping spirit by remembering how amid all the earth changes, how the hills still remain forever. What a holy power upon us the mountains have. They're great, they're majestic, they're strong. They're so close to God. They seem so full of God. They bring us so near Him, and they fill us so full of Him. One thing about that that's suggested in this text is when you need help and you can't find help on your level, then the next suggestion is to look up. This particular song begins by supposedly Daniel writing and talking about, I will lift up my eyes to the mountain where my help comes from. And he's not saying that his help is in the mountains. He's saying that his help comes from the place where the mountains are. When you look at the mountains, you see how high they are. You see how majestic they are. They're filled with smoke. And as you sit there and look at how big and powerful this amazing wonder is, you stop and think and say, you know what? Even though it's pretty big, God is bigger than this. When you stop and pause and look at the sky and see how the stars twinkle and they don't fall from their place, they were told to stay there. And in the nighttime, they shine because they were commanded to shine. And you sit there and think to yourself, God has to be higher than this. And when you go look at the sun, you say to the sun, Mom, you are bright, you are powerful, you are hot, you can kill, you can give life. But if you move 1 degree to the right, people will burn up. If you move 1 degree to the left, people will freeze. And you stand in motion because God commanded you to. And beyond, as majestic the sun is, God is still higher than that. When you look up at the sky and you just happen to take a stroll outside, you see the birds flying as if they have no care. They're flapping their wings as high as they want in the sky. And you stop and think they are flying mighty high, but God is higher than that. You go on a plane and you ride above the clouds and you never knew that there was a level like this before, and you sit and you ride and you look down and you see how far down it is and you see how high you are. But yet, even though you're high up, there's still another realm of height that you have not grasped. And you sit there and think, God has to be higher than this. When you sit there and watch the news and watch everything that's happening and you see life unfolding in your very presence, you have to sit there and say, there's got to be more to life than what I'm seeing. There's got to be more to this thing that I'm walking and moving in than what I'm saying. So this song just helps us deal with this anxiety he has. He doesn't know what's going to happen. He's in exile. He's looking forward to a future that seems dark, that seems brief. But he's saying to himself, I feel really discouraged right now. I feel really upset. I feel slighted that I'm sitting in the midst of catastrophe. But even in the midst of that, I want to think about how high God is. Because when everything on your level is not feeding your soul, it's time to start looking upward. And God is sitting there in this text, and he says, I will lift up my eyes to the mountains to bring us my help. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And he's literally highlighting to us that our help doesn't come from a White House. It comes from God being in your house. I understand we gotta do our part, I get it, but at the end of the day, God is still in control. God did not get voted in, God did not get voted out. He did not wake up on November 9th, sitting there scratching his head, trying to figure out how he's gonna govern the universe. He sat there and said, my children know my voice, and a stranger's voice they will not follow. My children that are mine, they're excited no matter what time we're in, because they understand that my world is framed by the words that come out of this book. That whatever God has for me and my family, we shall achieve them if we keep our eyes on Jesus. Now, he says, I don't want you just to look across from you, because if you look across, you'll get disappointed. You'll see people protesting. You'll see anger. You'll see hate. You'll see maliciousness. You'll see people coming out that you never thought were coming out. You'll see neighbors that you thought you knew that you didn't know. You'll see friends that you thought had expressed one certain ideology, and you realize that they don't express the same ideology as you. And then we find this important piece that happens. The important piece that happens is, he says, I will not look to what's going on around. around me, I will look to what's going on above me. Because I think this is a good season, because so many of us were looking at everybody else as opposed to looking upward. I'm so glad to see the folks. I'm coming to church this Sunday because it's forcing us to look upward. All of the help that you built does not sustain you. Parties won't sustain you. Lines won't sustain you. The only thing that will sustain you is God alone. If you're not paying attention, you need heavenly protection. You need divine assistance, because there are certain things that only God can do in your world. And I will look to the Maker of heaven and earth. And he says, this God that we pray to is not sleeping or is not slumbering. If you read that, you may not realize the value of that passage, because you're not in the Babylonian times. But in the Babylonian world, when they prayed, they had to hope that their God was not sleeping and was listening. So they would pray, and if they did not get an answer, they would be tripping, because they would say, well, maybe he's asleep. That's why he didn't answer us. Well, God says, let me just inject to you that I don't sleep, nor do I slumber. Even when you're sleeping, I'm still awake, thinking about how I'm going to organize and orchestrate your life. God's word already declares that he's predestinated us. Every step that you take, God has already arranged. Woo! What you're thinking, I made some bad steps. God is so smart that he knows how to recalculate you even when you made the wrong decisions. He knows how to reset yourself up. It may take you longer, but you're not lost, because he knows how to find you right where you are. And God says, I will look unto the hills with which God my help and make of heaven and earth. My God is not sleeping or slumber. When you sleep, God is up counting his goodness. When you sleep, God is up looking at his power, his authenticity. You're sleeping and you're chilling and you're drooling and you're snoring, and some of you got your mouth wide open, and you're not sleeping in peace because of your ADT. You're sleeping in peace because God had already dispatched angels around your house and said, I don't want anything to move in this house. I don't want anything to come nigh this house. I don't want anything to come nigh this dwelling. This is the house that the Lord has protected. And he says, I don't sleep nor slumber. While you sleep, I'm sitting there looking at my creation. I'm looking at the stars and I'm saying, oh, you, man, God, look how you made new stars twinkle. They shine, but they don't even show how great I am. They are a glimpse of my greatness. Look at the moon, how it's just shining in position. I love it. I love it. It signifies my goodness, my authority. And he looks down and sees you. He says, yep, there goes Sister Susie. That's my own right there. I number the hairs upon her head. She sold some hair and I still know how much she got. There goes John. That's my boy. He done got a fade. I know how much hair is on his head. He done got a mohawk. I even know how much. I'm so detailed. I'm so into their life. The crazy thing is, they're going to sleep concerned, and all I'm doing is thinking about how I'm going to set up their future. They're sitting there going to bed worried about what's going to happen tomorrow, and they don't even realize I'm so far beyond tomorrow. I'm already reading out tomorrow. Well, before you even went to sleep, before I called you, I knew you by name before you were formed in your mother's womb. I knew the thoughts that I had towards you. There were thoughts of peace and not of evil to get you to an expected end. I don't care who they elect, I still got an end for you to get to. I don't care where they go, I still got a purpose for you to achieve. And it doesn't matter how you feel about it, what you feel on the inside. Just look up and let yourself know. If up is not paranoid, then you shouldn't be paranoid. If up is not wondering, then you shouldn't be wondering. If up is not drinking latte to stay up, then you look up, because you can look up and think that's so high up that I can't reach or I can't contain it. But then he talks about the God. Because in this text it says this, that God is with the God of my right hand. And if you were to read that from a Western perspective, it means absolutely nothing to you because you're not from that culture. But what was important when he said that little detail was because the soldiers had all of their weaponry in their left hand. So their right hand was vulnerable, and God simply said, I'm not just the God that covers the areas that you got covered. I'm the God that covers the areas that you have exposed. So he's simply saying to you is that you got all of these things preparing yourself for battle, but there's a side of you that's still exposed that I will cover. And here's a very important thing. If you live long enough, you can do everything that you want to do the right way. There will be areas of your life that you want to anticipate that will just happen because life happens. You're driving down the street, all of a sudden you get a car accident, and now all of a sudden your whole body's all messed up. You didn't plan for that, life happens. End up going, send your kids to school, end up getting in trouble, goes to jail, life happens. These surprise attacks. That is why I've always emphatically said to people, don't rejoice when other people have life happen, because your time is coming next. It's just inevitable. Everybody will experience life. It's just a facet of humanity. We all will go through circumstances and seasons that we did not predict. We'll have children that we raise that we hope will serve the Lord, and then they turn out not serving the Lord. And you could have sat there in the old Baptist church, they used to do this. They used to talk about other people's children who got pregnant, and then when their children got pregnant, they act like they couldn't answer the phone, because you know life happens to come around sometimes, and you gotta learn how to navigate yourself. I was talking to my dear's mom, and I said, Mom, she's been praying for 40-30 years, Saturday morning, 18 to a bunch of old ladies who can't sing. And they sing together hymn notes all off key, all off beat, and they pray. And I sat there and talked to my mom, and I said, she said, son, you know, there are times where you wonder, how could God love you so much and let you endure so much? She said, I've been serving the Lord for a long time, and some of my children are not doing what I prayed for them to do. And there are times where I sit and look at the wicked and see how they're prospering, and I say to myself, Lord, are you really for me or against me? And then she said, at some point, when I'm saying this, baby, something kicks on the inside and says, if you've been with me this long, where else are you gonna go? And she says, then I realize I just had a little moment and I had to get back to myself, and then I say to myself that God will see me through this. So even if you're in a season where you don't feel it, but after a while you need to look inside yourself, remember all the stuff God has brought you through, and say to yourself, hold on, I know I'm tripping right now. I'm gonna give you 30 days to trip, 15 days, but if you're going on 3 months, you better start looking back over your life. God made a way where it seemed like every door was going to close, where it seemed like every obstacle was in front of you, and God sustained you. But you look within, because looking within is provocative, but not just look within, but something about look without. So when you look without, you see things that make you wonder, where is God in all this? And I like to say that sometimes chaos brings clarity. Sometimes the only way you see what you're in is God allows things to happen in the world so that you can start searching for what's really happening on the inside. Y'all ever play, when you were a kid, one of the kid games I used to play, very few outside of Bible I used to play, but we used to play Where's Waldo? And as you're looking at Where's Waldo, y'all ever play that? Y'all remember? Okay, praise God. So anyway, so in Waldo's story, you would go looking through this little thing trying to find where Waldo was. And what you would find is all of these pictures were there to distract you from finding what's the most important thing. And you would sit there and you'd look and you'd say, oh, I think he's right over there. And you'd get distracted by something else. And then all of a sudden, when your eyes start to focus on finding Waldo, even though there's all those other distractions around you, your eye has pinpointed itself on Waldo. And though there are other obstacles, objections, pictures, images, your eyes are no longer looking on those images. Your eyes are now focused because you found Waldo. And you're so excited, not because there's not other images. You're excited because you found the main thing in between all the other things. And all God is allowing you to do is to see him in the midst of all these other things. And maybe you can't see him because you're looking at all the other images. But if you look closely, God's hand is still in everything, because God has not forgotten about you.
In the midst of seeing Waldo, he says, be my God on my right hand, because I love God for this reason, that God is not just the God that parts of my strength, he's also the God of my vulnerabilities. See, these soldiers were so good at focusing where they were strong. But God says, there's an area that you're very weak in that I'm going to cover you until you get strong enough in it. Because if the adversaries come, they won't attack you when you're strong. They'll attack you when you're weak. Okay, so this is what it means. Most of us spend all our time building up our stronger parts because we don't want to take the time to work on our weaker parts. because it's easier to work on the parts that you're already good at, because it doesn't force you to deal with the you that doesn't want to deal with the parts that you're weak at. And God says, I'm not just going to ignore the part that you're weak at. I'm going to address it so that you know it, because you cannot live your life off your strength alone. Because there will come a time when the area that you should have worked on that was weak will come and expose. Okay, let me give you an example, because y'all listen. Have you ever seen somebody that just, if you're a male, you're not special, or the other way for saying this, I mean, a man pass for this. You see a gentleman and you're like, man, he is huge. And then, you know, he at the beach or whatever, he takes me like, wow, that dude, he's a big guy. I'm straight, but I gotta give much credit, that brother's a big guy. And then he takes off his pants and you're like, what just happened here? What just happened here? Why? Because all along, he spent all of his time focusing on the parts that grow the fastest. But he negated the parts that don't grow as quickly. And when it was important, he was embarrassed, not because of his strength, but because of his weakness. You laugh, and that's what happens when the devil looks at you. He sits there and says, oh, you're working on your strong parts, but your weak parts you don't pray about. The strong parts you celebrate, but the weak parts you don't talk about. And he laughs because he says, oh, you're an easy target, because I know where you put all your time into. But he says, the sun and the moon, I'll protect you from. Because what would hurt travelers was the heat of the day. And what would kill them at night is the light of the moon. Because sometimes the thing that's supposed to help you can hurt you. And God has to protect you from things that you count on. Because sometimes we count on things so much that we don't realize that they pass away. See, humanity, putting your trust in humans is great, and there should be some level of that. But at the end of the day, they pass away too. You can't put all your hope in your job because that fades away. You can't put all your hope in your family because they turn sometimes. You can't put all your hope in your friends because they change depending upon the season that you're in. So there's only one thing that's constant and consistent, and that's God alone. God is constant and consistent. See, the problem is you want to get married because you're looking for constant and consistency. Marriage ain't that. The only thing that's constant and consistent is God alone. So everything that you hope that will bring you joy won't bring you joy. If I just get a baby, I'll be happy. You got a baby in your arms, rubbing it down, hugging it, holding it, and you realize that still doesn't complete you because it's not constant and consistent. The only thing that's constant and consistent in your life is that you hang up your life at the fact that no matter what happens in my world, there's a God that will never be too busy for me not to answer my call. It doesn't matter what time I call him, it doesn't matter how late it is, how groggy I am, how upset I am, he never sleeps nor slumbers. It's very good that he wrote that in the passage, because he says, God never sleeps nor slumbers. I got my pastor. You may call him and his phone may be off. You may text him and he may not respond. You may call the church and it may be after hours and you can't get any aid. But there is a number that never goes off. There is a, and maybe God is allowing you to see all these things in your world so you can see what's really important. But not just God, Son, Moon, and protect you from what he says. Emphatically, in verse number 5, the Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. Sun and moon will not harm you. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forever. He will watch over your life. Let me say that one more time. He will watch over your life. Y'all say that, not your life. He will watch over your life. You're coming and you're going. Some of you drive, don't even ask God to watch over you. In the old sense, you say, Lord, take the wheel. You don't even do that. But he will watch over you and you're going and you're coming. And he will watch over. He will watch over you and you're going and you're coming. And he will watch over. He will watch over you and you're going That means going to the grocery store. That means going out to the meat market. That means going to the market. He will watch where you're going and you're coming. And he will watch over. There's something that he needs over here, but he's been thinking that that is the person that's going to get it for him. So he's been praying, and God said, no, I need him to get over here. But his hope is in what he sees. Because he heard what I said. But he's interpreting what I heard, what I said to him, as that is the key to getting him. And so, because he's been praying to me that I watch over his life, take care of his life, and I don't want him to get distracted by what he sees, I want him to know that I have the right people in place to help him, no matter who's in position. And so when you and I pray, we get up and we start thinking about who God is going to use in our world to make this happen. Who do I know? And you got all your hope in this person, because this person got all these credentials. This person got all these qualifications. This person knows this person. And this person said, if you just give me a call, I'll look out for you. I got you. I'll take care of you. And just like humans, we want to put our hope in everybody else's basket except for God. We're looking for a savior. Whoever it may be, save me, be my leader. God's like, I'm trying to do something new in your life. I'm trying to do something fresh in your life. I'm trying to do something to where that only I can get the credit out of. So what I will do is, sometimes chaos brings good. Now, Elijah every day has to pass by this guy. But because this guy doesn't look as swaggerish as that guy, he only talks to this guy. So every day he's walking by this guy. That's his answer, but don't see that as his answer. Oh, my words, can I borrow this from you? Your little numbers, can I borrow that little sheet that you got on your sheet? Not the one on your leg, the one on your back. Yeah, the clock. Yeah. So here's what happens. I like this. Good thing. See, you can't see what you're supposed to see because your eyes are still focused on the things around you. So even though every day you're walking past what God has for you, you can't see it because you think that that person is going to be the one that brings you out. You think that person is going to be the one to deliver you. You think that person is going to be the one to hook you up. You think that person is going to be the one to be there for you. He's going to be my baby. He's going to be my boo. He's going to be my everything. He's going to be the walking off. He's going to be everything I need, everything I hope for, everything I dream for, everything I've been longing for. He is my everything. And you're putting all your confidence in this person, and God has a funny way of, I need to make sure he sees this guy. But the only way he will see this guy is if I get rid of this guy. And all of a sudden, what God does is, he will get rid of this guy through somebody else. Now, this guy, he's going to leave your life. Get him out of here. Get him out of here. He's out of here. He's out of here. He's out of here. See, now what happens is you and I start going through our funky season. We start saying, well, now I don't know why I'm wasting my time getting to know people. I don't know why I get all of this. I don't know why this is happening in my life. Why is it always happening to me? Why is God always picking on me? I know I got a call on my life, but I didn't know it took all of this. I don't want to go through this. I'm tired of going through. And God is sitting there saying, I'm just trying to help you. Because you wouldn't get rid of them yourself. I ended up getting rid of them for you. And now your eyes can see what you're supposed to see. Now your ears can hear what you're supposed to hear. Now your heart can receive what I want to give you. But you still don't see this guy. But God has to serve you. Because it's not that he's not your provider. It's your perception of him is not where it's supposed to be. So he has to fine-tune your perception so you can see the way you're supposed to see. See, glasses, all they do is help fine-tune what you cannot see in your natural sight. And so what God is doing is allowing things to happen in your world to fine-tune your seeing, because your ability to see is off because you have so much confidence in somebody else. And now that you're in a season of loneliness, in a season where you feel like you're alone and it feels like the world is against you, it feels like nobody understands you, nobody can feel what you're feeling, that is when God is revealing to you the Waldo of your life. And this guy, he has always been there. He's always been standing there. He's always been waiting, but you just didn't see him. And maybe your prayer should stop being, God, give me more money. God, give me a new job. God, give me a better man. Maybe it should be, God, open up my eyes to see. Open up my ears to hear. Romans 8 says creation is waiting for the manifestation of sons and daughters of God. God is revealing stuff to you that others can't see. And God is showing you what no one else can see. He's been there all along. But you just kept on overlooking him because you kept on looking at everything else. You kept looking at your job. You kept looking at your 401k. And God slowed everything in the world down to get you to realize. And I hear the glory. So what do we do from here? Micah 6:8, and I'm gone. Do justice. Love mercy. And walk before God humbly. Now I'm not one of the Christians that just sit there and say, yo, what you should do, what you should do, pray. I'm not getting out there watching you. You do justice. You hold people accountable. You do justice.
You show up at the courts when you got jury duty. You do justice. You don't have from jury duty. You take it because it's an opportunity to get righteous perspective in a room. You do justice. You love mercy. You give mercy and you walk before God humbly. I'm not better than you. I'm just trusting a God that's higher than you. I'm not saying I respect you are my brother, but you're not my Lord. You are my president, absolutely, but you're not my Lord. You are my boss, but you're not my Lord. You are my employer, but you're not my source. You are my employer, but you're not my source. I'm not giving anybody the credit above my God. I will walk humbly before God. I will do justice. If I see a young man on the street corner and I can influence him, I'll pull him to the side and do justice. I'll sit there and give women words of wisdom that may not look like you, that may not act like you. Do justice. God did it for you. Now that you got your educated self, go down the street and metro in the hood. Do justice. Don't sit there and roll your spiritual eyes and talk about, I'm just going to trust the Lord and believe in his sovereignty. Sovereignty does not remove man's responsibility. Do justice. Find a way to be justice-seeking. And number two, love and mercy. You can't love God and give mercy to everybody else and not give mercy to the people that sit next to you on Sunday. You love Jesus, but don't love the people next to you. Love and mercy. And walk before God humbly. You may be up today. You may be down tomorrow. You may be riding today, but you'll be catching the dust tomorrow. Micah 6, verse 8. Do justice. Don't sit there and just pray. That's not enough. That's Christian's excuse to do nothing. Yeah. Do justice. Don't sit silent when you shouldn't be silent. Do justice. I'm just going to pray about it. What did God tell you to do while you were praying? Because God should give you a response after prayer. Either he's telling you yes, no, or wait, but he should have told you something. Do justice. Do justice. See young men on the basketball court, talk to them. Do justice. Speak life into others. Be the community. Don't just sit there and say, I'm praying, because prayer is an easy excuse. Because most people say prayer for you, they're not. I'm just going to tell you, they're not. Oh, man, you lost somebody. Oh, man, I'm praying for you. How long did you really pray? Really? Do justice. Love and mercy. Christians give everybody mercy except for the people that are close to them. Love and mercy. You cannot love a Jesus and hate your brother that worships you. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sins. And you roll your eyes at the sister that's sitting on the same road with you. You have to do justice, love and mercy, and walk before God humbly. Walking before God humbly is looking out for the least of these. Because if God has blessed you, he can bless you just so you can tweet about it, take pictures on Instagram. He blessed you so that you can walk humbly before him. So stop crying about what you think, what you feel, and start trusting. Your career is in God's hands. So you got fired, that was the greatest thing God could have ever done for you. Because him firing you helped you see what was really out there for you. And let you experience that so that you can know it for yourself. Justice. Trust him. And lean on to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him. Shall direct your power. Last time I told this guy, God raised the powers up and down, called properly and prayed with Rick Samuels here, and I prophesied that God was going to win the candidacy he won. Hopefully, he's going to free property taxes for the rest of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. On Wednesday night, God gave me a word for somebody that had $42 in their account. Got an email that same night, so Pastor, I had $42 exactly in my account.
And I had given up on this job that I was believing God for because I got discouraged. And I heard God tell me that night, if you're going to put your confidence in me, put it in me, oh Lord. How many of you know what I can talk about 42 hours? God has a way just to convince you that He's God, and what we're saying is most of the people who say they believe, they really had a bad perception of who Jesus really is in their life. They think His blood saves them from sins, but they don't think His blood leads their life. I'm just trying to get your faith up. I'm just trying to get your confidence up. That you don't know what to hide in, you don't know what to exile. Your Father has this. I'm not saying that we won't go through troubles, times, or calamity. I am saying whatever we go through, as long as He don't leave my house, I'll be okay with anything that comes to my house. So in this last 10 seconds of preaching, as I'm finished, and I know some of y'all think about going to get your kids because I can feel your attitude when you drop them off. I want you to find one person and say, this is the part of the message. Look at somebody that looks better than you. Find one person that looks better than you. Since you can't find nobody, just look at your neighbor. Just look at your neighbor. Just can't find nobody.
Come down that low to talk to you about that. You can't even comprehend what I'm Precious blood of
activity, it's very important that we support the arts. One of the big things is I want the arts to come into the inner city so that we don't have to go to Dr. Phillips Performing Arts Center to see a great show. I want it to be able to be housed in a local environment. $20 is not an expensive venture. You will enjoy yourself. You will have a state-of-the-art presentation that reflects excellence. So make sure you call the office on Tuesday and start getting your tickets. I want to make sure that we are on a bookstore, so I want to make sure that we support. Because inner city, Afro-Americans, Kushites, Black folk, don't oftentimes support the arts. And so I want us to support the arts. One of our own is doing it. And he's using actors within the church and stuff. So I want you to, December 10th, we have two shows, December 10th and 11th. It's going to be great. I want you to make sure you buy the tickets. It's $20. Just only get one eyelash next week and say you have to pay for it. $20. Make sure you do that. So please, buy the tickets. If you're still ready, invite us to wait. Father, make good seeds. Bless them all in the name of Jesus. Presence. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hug somebody, be a good Christian.